Yeah, in the last session, I discussed about what is measures of central tendency. And also we discussed about the four types of variables or the scales of measurement. The one is the nominal, the other one is ordinal, and the other one is interval and ratio, right? Interval and ratio. Okay, and Sarnath, I did not discuss about, right? Sarnath, Mahesh and Kumar. I think I somehow missed out this one. Okay, anyhow, don't worry. If you remain in this session, right? Probably 15 minutes post this session, right? We'll discuss that, okay? Probably during the course of this session, today's session, I'll try to, recap that also. As part of, so we discussed about, one second, let me just write it down so that, see the course study material, everything is available in my website. But again, in the interest of adding some more content to the existing course content, right, we are making some more changes with respect to the look and feel and also adding some more contents in order to help you to, crack the interviews in case of any online interviews, anything, right? So we put more quizzes, everything, okay, there. So that effort is in progress. Just give me a second, let me. Yeah, this is solid. This is there already. We discussed about four types of scales of measurement. Okay, the scales of measurement. So one is the nominal variable, and the other one is ordinal. Anyhow, I'll just give you a quick overview about this one, okay, and nominal interval and ratio also. So this is the, scales of measurement, you should be aware of it. In statistics, while performing statistical analysis, in order to classify the data with different types, right? They came up with like four different scales of measurement or four different types of variables. So these two are called qualitative data. These two are called qualitative data. Qualitative data. And these two are called quantitative data. Quantitative data or quantitative variables. Okay. So the question is, these two are qualitative data, then why do we need to have two different names here? There is a reason behind this, okay? There is a discrimination behind these two things. That is the reason why in the qualitative data itself, they created two different types of variables. The nominal is simply to label the data. Okay, label the data. For example, insurance data. You have something called insurance claim data. Insurance claim data. In the insurance claim data, right? You need to have, for example, if you want to, let's say your insurance policy, recently got, the maturity, right? They reached the maturity now, okay? The insurance policy now recently, right, reached the maturity. So you are eligible for, let's say 1 lakh or 2 lakh, okay? The sum assured is, okay, again, so here the policy number, sum assured. What is sum assured? How much, what is the sum assured? Okay, let's say you purchased a policy for 15 lakhs. 150,000. Okay, 150,000. 1,50,000. Or let's say 15 lakhs, right? Okay. Yeah, 15 lakhs. You purchased a policy for 15 lakhs. Okay, it covers the risk, like, you know, the health risk or anything else. Okay, the policy number is A001, something like that. So let's say you're right now, your claim number, now it is the maturity amount. Okay, the maturity amount is every once in 10 years, but the duration is, you know, this one is for 25 years, but every once in 10 years, you will get 1 lakh rupees, 100,000, 1 lakh rupees, this is the maturity. Okay, fine. Likewise, right, many customers, they purchased the policy from your insurance company and you have the policy number, sum assured and claim number and maturity amount, everything is there. Okay. And let's say your manager is asking you, hey, how many number of male customers are there in this insurance, those applied for claim, right? How many of them are males? How many of them are females? If he asks you, can you tell with this, with these variables? I don't want to, you know, put many variables here. Okay, this is, let's say this is my claim number. Claim number, sum assured, policy number and maturity. Okay, and maturity date, everything is there. Maturity date and policy holder name and age, so on and so forth. Likewise, many columns are there, but simplicity sake, I just took only 4 columns for illustration purpose. Okay. Now, you have another column called eligibility. Okay, eligibility. Are they eligible for the, yeah, because they reach the maturity, it says yes. And with this data, likewise, many policy holders are there. Their maturity, you know, even for their policy, you know, the maturity date got, you know, reached and they applied for the claim for that. In that case, if your manager asking, hey, how many, let's say you have 10,000 policy holders, claim you received it, right? For 10,000 claims, out of the 10,000 claims, how many claims were related to male? How many claims were related to female? Can you tell with this itself? You cannot tell, right? You need to have a gender column. It's kind of labeling. You are labeling, okay, this claim is related to male and this claim is made by female, male, female, something like that, okay? Forget about the dependent name and all, okay? Dependent, not dependent, the, what is that here? The hair, hair, right? Hair. So, okay. So likewise, many columns are there. So in order to answer your manager, right? So let's say out of 10,000, 7,100 claims were filed by males and remaining, the rest of them were females. In order to tell this, you need to have a column called gender. Gender is a categorical variable. It is also called as categorical data, categorical variable. You can say categorical data or categorical variable, right? It's also called as, these two are called as quality data, and also it is called categorical variable, right? So male, female. If you have the categorical variable like gender, then you can answer him like this. So out of 10,000 claims, 7,100 claims were made by male, the rest of them were made by female. If you don't have this categorical variable, how can you classify that, right? So basically here we are, you know, labeling the claims, each and every claims we are labeling it with the help of the gender column in order to answer to my manager's query, okay? So without this, we cannot tell, right? This may simply we are labeling, okay? Instead of saying male, instead of using a text value, we can also do some kind of encoding. In statistics, we use the term encoding. For male, we put 1, female, we use 0. This is the conventional way of doing encoding, okay? Right? So we don't use 1, 2 and all. So instead we say 1, 0. 1 is male and female is 0. Okay, so using this also, we can identify which claims are related to male, which claims are related to female, right? This basically to classify the data, we use, we call that as a nominal type. These kind of variables are called, these kind of categorical variables are called nominal variable. supposing here, right, the ordinal type of variable, this is also a categorical variable. Let's say you have something called, let's say you have automobile data set, okay, automobile data set, your car, this one, the manufacturing date of your car, the number of owners of your car, and also, right, based on the past history, the risk, right? What is the risk of this, policy holder, right? So this policy holder bought the car in 2010, 10 year old car, right? Then there is a high risk. This car can develop some issues, right? High risk, medium risk, low risk, right? This policy holders or this vehicle is high risk, medium risk, low risk, right? So based on which the premium amount will be determined, high risk, medium risk, low risk, right? So here, let's say your manager is asking you how many number of claims are related to high risk, or how many number of policy holders vehicles are high risk, medium risk, low risk, because based on which we need to come up with the appropriate premium amount. Obviously, higher the risk of a vehicle, right? The premium should also be paid high, because the number of owners are more and your driver is driving the car. Already you met the three to four times accidents. Okay, so those kind of, right? So you have column called high risk, medium risk, low risk. This is a categorical variable. Even gender is also categorical. Even the risk column is also a categorical variable. At the maximum, only three will be there. At the maximum, only two distinct values will be there, right? Maximum three distinct or two distinct values will be there. It will not have, it is not a unique variable column, unique variable column. In RDBMS, we use the term primary key or unique variable, right? Each and every record will have a unique value, policy number, right? Each customer, the policy number is different, unique value. That is not a categorical variable. If you take a distinct values in a variable, especially in the categorical type of variable, right? Text, string variable or character variable, the number of distinct values should be much lesser, right? It should be small compared to your total number of records, okay? But high and the risk and gender, both of them are categorical variable. But here in the case of high, we call this as an ordinal variable. We call it an ordinal variable. Why? Because there is an order here. This high risk is superior than a medium risk. Medium risk is superior than low risk. Okay. There is an order here, right? So high, medium, low, right? Because for high risk, you need to, come up with a higher premium rate. And for this one, medium premium rate, this one is low premium, because this customer purchased just now the car and he's a single owner. In that case, and also he never met with an accident. In that case, the risk is very less, and hence the premium should be, very less, okay, compared to other two classes. Okay, here we have three classes compared to other two classes, this one. Hence, high risk should be paid more, given more importance, right? That means higher premium should be charged and moderate premium should be charged, unless there is an order here. Other example is appraisal rating, right? So if you get 1, 2, 3, 4, one is outstanding and here very good, and this is meeting the expectations, 4 is needs improvement. So 1 is superior than 2, 2 is superior than 3, 3 is superior than 4. There is a superiority comes into picture here. In a nutshell, the categorical variable, the values of the categorical variable intrinsically, if that has an order in it, we call that as an ordinal type of variable. It is as simple as that. But in the case of male and female, can we say male is superior than female, female is superior than male? No. This is just a placeholder. One is to identify male. These claims are related to male. These claims are female. To classify that, we are using some values. But conventionally, we use this notation, 1 or 0. I would say notation, right? Instead of saying 1, 0, use a notation, 1, 0, that's all. Here, there is no superiority, inferiority, but whereas in the case of appraisal rating, yes, other examples, you know, the defect severity, right? So you're in testing team. So high, medium, low, right? High risk, medium risk, low risk. High defect severity, right? It will have a serious impact. So it has to be fixed within 2 hours or 3 hours of time. But whereas medium risk, if you take 4, 6 to 8 hours, fine. But low risk, low severity, right? Maybe 2 to 3 days time. The turnaround time is okay. Right? So there is order comes into picture. In simple term, ordinal variable, though it is a categorical variable, ordinal, the values stored in the categorical variable are intrinsically has some order in it. So it has some order in it. Whereas here, there is no order. That is the difference between these two. But end of the day, these two are called your qualitative or categorical variable. But explain you the machine learning algorithms, we will be using this term nominal variable, ordinal variable. Okay. Just remember that. Okay. And next we have interval and ratio. These two are quantitative variable. And the interval is, this is the discrete. It is also called as a discrete variable. Discrete, D-I-S, discrete variable. In simple term, you just remember that this is a whole number. Supposing somebody is asking how many defects you captured from the so and so module, so you would say either 10 or 8 or 6. You never say 6.222 defects I found in his code, right? You never say. So you will be saying that you will be discrete variable in simple term. It holds something values like this, the whole number. It holds whole number, something like this. Okay. And in the case of ratio, it is a continuous variable. Continuous variable. You cannot use whole number all the time. For example, the weight, body weight, right? So body weight and temperature, body temperature, right? And again, the wages of the employees. And these are all in terms of, you will have the decimal values in it. Right. Especially the weight is very important, right? Let's say you are measuring the weight of a laptop because you want to ship it through the courier company to your friend who lives in Bangalore. So every, the weight, every gram, 500 grams counts, right? Matters a lot. So in that case, the decimal values, the variable which holds the decimal values, right? That is called your continuous variable. You just think that way, that is more than sufficient. Whole number, your decimal values, okay? It will have decimal values in it. Whereas here, it is very simple. This is just a label. And this is, intrinsically, it has some order in it. That's all. So this is what we discussed as part of the fundamentals of statistics. Very first day, right? So that's all. The next one is, what else we discussed? We discussed about the measures of central tendency, like mean, median, and mode. Right, all these things. And also we use some terms like outlier, exceptionally very high value or extremely very small value or abnormality, right? That is what outlier. This is the term we discussed. And also we discussed about range and also we discussed about standard deviation. Variation 1, 2, and 3. And this one is coefficient of variation. Coefficient of variation, and we'll discuss about this one also once again with some other example. And this one is percentiles, quartiles. We'll discuss about that also, okay, in today's session. So range, we know the difference between maximum and minimum, right? Range does not take into account of each and every value. It requires only two values, maximum, minimum, that's all. But it is sensitive to outlier. But in the case of standard deviation, it takes into account of each and every values in the given data set. Even standard deviation also sensitive to outlier. But with the help of standard deviation, we can tell clearly, right, how far each values are deviating from the mean. This is your mean. Mean is there in the middle. In the case of normally distributed data, the mean will be there in the middle. How far each value is deviating from the mean, right? That you can tell using standard deviation, but range you cannot tell. Okay, that is also another disadvantage of range. And the next one is coefficient of variation. So the what is the advantage of standard deviation? With the help of standard deviation, we will get to know how spread out the data is, whether it is spread out, this is my mean, whether all the given data are clustered around the mean, this is my mean, all the values are clustered around mean, or is it too far from the mean, or some cases it will be something like, right, this is too far. How spread the data is. So with the help of standard deviation, we get to know, right, by applying the standard deviation, we'll get to know how inconsistent or how volatile the given, or we can we use the standard deviation to check the consistency of the data set. And also I told you that using standard deviation, we can compare two data sets. Fine. So also the standard deviation is used by the insurance, what is that person name? I forgot. There is a, you know, they call the underwriter, right? Underwriter in insurance, they use standard deviation to measure the risk. And also the other guy in insurance company, I forgot that name here. So even that guy, even the insurance, right? They use standard deviation. Stock market also, they use standard deviation. How volatile a stock is, what is the variation, right? So if the specific equity is, the variation is very less, then it is a better option to invest there, right? Make an entry there. And next one is coefficient of variation. The coefficient of variation is nothing but the standard deviation to the mean. The ratio of standard deviation to the mean is called your coefficient of variation. I'll write it neatly. Coefficient of variation. Okay. Which is nothing but the standard deviation to mean. The next one is, you just hold your thought here. We'll show you with some example later. Okay. Now we will jump into percentiles. Okay. Before I dive in here, right, we are discussing about measures of spread. Okay, so how do you find out the distribution of your data, whether it is normally distributed or skewed data? How do you get to know that? How do you find out? So we use the visualization tools like the histogram. This is my histogram. As I told you, right, the histogram is something like this. There is no gap between the bars. You find something like this. If you get something like this, right, using histogram, you can find out the distribution. It not necessarily it has to be like this, right? When you join this, or just by looking at this, you can tell, right? So it is, you know, gradually growing up and gradually, you know, falling down the bars, right? So it is very normal. But in real world, you cannot get this type of thing, right? Most of the time, you will get approximately normally distributed data. And sometimes, not sometimes, even, right, in most of the, in some, yeah, most of the time, right, your the histogram, when you look at this, it will be something like this. And then suddenly, right, it will be like this. So it will come like this, and then it will fall suddenly. Abruptly, it is falling down. The tail is flattening, okay? So this is kind of, right, okay, this is also kind of, you know, normally distributed because it's going up. But here, yeah, this is, you know, positive skew, right side skew, right? It's a skew, it's not normally distributed, this positively skewed or right skewed data, right? By using histogram, we can determine whether the given variable, for example, salary or sales, right? So, or these variables or the distribution of the variable, you can find out using histogram. And also we have something called box plot. Using box plot also you can find out the distribution pattern, whether the salary or any quantitative variables values are normally distributed or not, right? To understand the distribution pattern, you can use either histogram or box plot. Okay. Fine, you understood now. So today we'll discuss about the box plot visualization also. Okay, and also I discussed about fine number summary. Except the yesterday's people, okay. What is fine number summary? If anybody says, or if your peers or seniors, senior data scientists, if they ask you, what is, can you tell me the fine number summary? We just note it down, okay, minimum. The second one is quartile one. Third one is quartile three. One second. Quartile three. And the fourth one is the maximum. And the fifth one is median. We know what is median. Median is the middle value, right? Median is the middle value. Right? This is what the fine number. This is called fine number summary. Please remember this, okay? Probably you can note it down. So minimum, maximum, quartile one, quartile three, the median. Median is nothing but, you know, middle value. So, you know, don't literally go by fine number summary, but when you use the statistical software in addition to that, you will get the mean also. You will get six number summary also when you use the statistical software, especially in Pandas, Python, we have a package called Pandas. There you have something called method is available. When you use that method, it gives you the six number summary about your quantitative variable. In addition to that, it gives you the measures of spread also, okay? But in general, if somebody asks you, what is fine number summary? You can say the minimum, maximum, quartile one, quartile three, median. Don't say mean, okay, fine number summary, median. And, using statistics only you can get the six number summary. Mean also you can get it. This also we discussed, but you know what is minimum, maximum, I don't have to teach you. And mean is nothing but the average, and the median is the middle value. And you are not aware of what is quartile one, quartile three. We'll discuss about quartile one and quartile three in today's session. Okay, don't worry. Okay, so we'll start with understanding the percentiles. What is percentiles? How many of you are aware of in the exam, right? The GATE exam and other exams that they use this term percentiles. Right? The percentiles are nothing but the descriptive set. It gives us the reference point in our data set. Right? It gives us the reference point in our data set. It is nothing but the value of a variable below with a certain percentage of observations fall. Okay. The most commonly used percentiles are, one second, percentile, right? I would say it is the value of a variable. Okay, it is the value of a variable which a certain percentage of observations fall. You might find different definitions, but it's all same as this one. Okay, let's take the mark example. Suppose score, right? You scored in an exam 78. Your score is 78, and it is falling in the percentile. The percentile is 50th. Your score is 78, but you are in the 50th percentile. It's kind of a ranking. Okay. What it says is, right? It means that what it says is, it means that 50% of the data values, data values fall at or below 78. Fall at or below 78. That means 50% of the students in your class, they scored values less than 78, or some people they scored similar to that of your mark. In other words, the remaining 50% of the students, they scored more than 78 or more than 78 marks in your class. That is what percentile is telling us. This is the one, the GATE exam and other exams, right? Those students, they appear for, they get something like your score is 78, your percentile is 7. That is, it's kind of a rank, okay? 50% of the students whose mark is 78, less than your mark, less than, right? 50, let's, you know, your data set is this one, okay? The 50% range is here, right? 50% of data is here, 50% of data is above your mark. So your mark is 78, 50% of the students, they scored less than 78 or 78, right? Because some students, they would have scored similar to that of your mark, right? They scored 50, some people, they scored 78 of yours and, but less than your mark. That is what it tells, okay? But on the right side, the remaining 50% of students, they would have got either 78 or more than 78. Let's say if the percentile is, this, you know, 70%, 70th percentile, right? 70th, that means, and let's say the score remains 70, that means 70% of the students in your class, they scored either less than your mark 78. That means 70% of the students in your class, they scored less than 78 or 78. In other words, the remaining 30% of the students who scored 78 or more than 78. Right? So that is how we interpret the percentile. In general, the quartiles are the one you know is used. The commonly the reported percentiles are quartiles. The commonly represented the percentiles or quartiles. What is quartiles? Dividing the data set into four equal parts. Dividing the data set into four equal parts. For example, you have something, 1, 2, 3, 4. Here 25% of your data will be there. Listen very carefully. Here 25, I'm going to ask you a question regarding this 25%. So your entire data will be divided into four equal parts. So in a year, we have four quarters. Similarly, quartiles are nothing but dividing the data set into four equal parts. Okay. That is what is called as quartile. For example, let us take some numbers. I'll just write out some numbers to find out the 25th quartile. They say the Q1, I told you, right? As part of fine number summary, we have Q1, Q3. Q1 is also called as 25th percentile. First quarter, okay? And usually we call Q2 as a median, middle value. We never say 50th percentile. Most of the time they use the term median. And Q3 is nothing but, say, it is also called as 75th percentile. And Q4 also, we never say, the Q4 or 100th percentile. Okay, we never say. Usually, we in practice, the statistician, they use these two terms, Q1 and Q3. Right? And for this, they use the term called median. They never say, the fourth quartile, okay? The fourth quartile, okay? Q1, Q3 only will be, using it to infer the given data. Supposing I'm going to write some data here. Let's say, 90 and 87 and 86, 84. Sorry, yesterday also I had the same problem. 84 and and 82, and let's say, you know, 74 and 74 and let's say, you know, 76. System is hanging. Okay, 76, 77 and 74 and 72, 80, sorry, 1 second, 72 and let's say, you know, some values, 65 and 65 and 62. 1 second, sorry. So how many values are there? 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, 12, 14, 1 second, 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, 10, 12, 14, 15. Let me, you know, include another value, 61. 16 values are there here. Okay, in this data set, we have 16 values are there. So now you tell me what is the median here. What is the median here? Median is the middle value, right? Median is the middle value. So it is already in the ascending order, right? So, okay, here it is descending order. We can use descending order also, right? We can use descending order also. What is the middle value here? The middle value is overall, we have 16, isn't it? So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. So here, just below this, you have 8 values, right? So 16. And so you need to take the two middle value, okay? Take the two middle value and add them together divided by 2. And here, so you will get 76.5. This is the median, middle value, which is nothing but the Q2. We never say Q2, instead we call that as a median. But if you look at the internet, they use some formulas to obtain the Q1 and Q3. The simple way of finding out the Q1 and Q3 is, see, this is your median, right? I'm going to draw a line here. 2, 4, 6, 7. Sorry, including this. 1 second.
Yeah, we have to either use descending or ascending, right?
Yeah, yeah.
In this case, I don't think that 76 and 71 will be the median.
Yeah, we'll say in 77 and 76. Okay, 76.
Before that, there is 274. Then it will go up.
Yeah, yeah. So don't worry about this. Okay, don't literally go by this. Okay, let's say 71, 71, right? This is 70, and this is like 69, okay, 69, 65, something like this. Or else, you know, better, I will write it neatly. There should not be any confusion. I'll just write it neatly. Let's say, you know, I'm going to use something called 93 and 89. 1 second, you know, what is this? So I'm going to use something called 89 and I'm going to use 1 second, yeah, it is 89 and 88. My system is hanging, please bear with me. Whenever I use, I thought this issue got fixed.
Can you go with Excel for this number?
Yeah, that is good here. So let me close this thing, it's painful thing, it takes let me use some numbers here. 1 second, I think some other problem happened. My system is freezing. Some software is causing problem, especially when I connect to Zoom, it is hanging. Because all along I've been working on this, no issues. Whenever I use something, even yesterday I was posing the same issues. 1 second. I think the problem with the Python is a open source, 100% CPU mint. Okay, this is a problem. 1 second. You see, this Python is spawning like anything. Unnecessarily, first of all, I did not use Python, invoke Python. Some virus issue is there. Just bear with me today. Okay, I'll fix it tonight. Yesterday itself, I tried. It was not working. But when I use the antivirus software, it is quarantining the Python. I don't want that to happen. But still, Python, I can use it on cloud. But still, to install advanced packages, it is not working on the cloud. Also, some issues came up. In the previous version of Windows, we have something called end task. We have something child process, right? So it will kill all the spawned. One second, let me just.
Can go to details and kill entire Python, like it will be end process.
Oh really? Okay, okay, good, good. Okay. Yeah, it is over now. I got over fine, everything. Okay, good. But still, it shows CPU 100%. Okay, details as you said. I will just check here. Yeah, the Python thing that you are like, yeah, in process is really good. Let me do one thing. See, the Python is still alive. Okay, okay, now it is clearing up. Google Chrome. If I kill this, Zoom will get so I don't think so. Zoom will have issue. Let me do one thing. I will end task. Yeah, it is good now, right? So sort of it is okay now. It is falling down. The CPU is getting, you know, freed now a little bit. Yeah, I'll just type it here. Let me use some numbers. Let's say we'll start with some random numbers. We'll start with the descending value, something. Let me use something like 93. Let's say 93 and 89. Something like 88, because this is very simple technique to find out the quartile 1 and quartile 3, but any of the statistical softwares are available. 80, all right, so 84, some numbers, 82 and 81, something like 81. It's all in descending. Am I correct? Right. So how many values are there here?
16
are there, right? So what are the, what is the mean median? It's already in descending order,
right? 79 and 78.
And the bottom up also, right? The median is 78, right? 78. Oops. 78 is the median, which is nothing but your, what is that? Which is nothing but your 50th percentile. Okay. And just below this, right? This is the median is somewhere between these. So if I draw a line in between 78, these two 78, right? So that is the one dividing the 50% of the data above and 50% of the data below this. 2, 4, 6, 8, right? From year 8 and from year 8. If I draw a line in between these two 78, that is what your median. But again, you need to add these two values and divide by 2. Since these two values are 78, 78 plus 78 divided by 2 is 78, 50th percentile. And just the simple technique, just below this, right? Just below this line, you assume that these two 78, right? In between these two 78, there is a line. Just below this line, you need to find out another middle value. What is the next middle value here? So here, 4, right? 4 and 4. In between these, the 4 values and 4 values, if you draw a line, 73 and 72. 72.5. 72.5. That is what your Q1, right? This is what your 25th percentile. 25th percentile is 72.5. Now you tell me what is the 75th percentile? Same technique. So now you need to find out the median.
83.
Two middle values are there, right? 83. This is your Q3 and this is your Q1. That's all. Okay, now you understood what how to find out the first quartile and third quartile, and you know what is median, right? Median is also called as the middle value. Apart from this, we have something else called IQR. What is IQR? Interquartile range. Interquartile range. IQR stands for interquartile range. I'll just type it. Interquartile range, which is nothing but Q3 minus Q1. This is what your interquartile range. Okay, Q3 minus Q1. The IQR. Okay. So when I show you something called the box plot, you will be able to understand. So now what is the minimum value here? The minimum value is 62. What is the maximum value?
93.
So the minimum is 62, maximum is 93, the median is 78, and the Q1 is 72.5, and Q3 is 83. So we have five number summary. You got the five number summary. Minimum, Q1, Q3.
Max.
The minimum is 62. The maximum is 93. Sorry, Q1. Q1 is
83.
Median.
78.
Yeah, correct. Maximum is 93. Yeah. So this is the five number summary. This is the fine number. Okay. So we have something called box plot. Using box plot, we can plot this fine number summary. And also, box plot is very much handy in terms of identifying the pattern of the distribution. Okay, pattern of the distribution. I'll use it once again. I don't know if my this issue is with this one or something else. Or else better I use the PowerPoint itself. PowerPoint will not have this issue. Okay, let me just open the PowerPoint. See, your box plot is something like this. This straight line, okay. You know, don't think there's a bend here, okay. Here,
It is something like this here. So this one is your minimum. This one is your minimum, and this is your, this one is your maximum. Okay, this line is your maximum. And your Q1 is here. Q1. And this is what your Q3. Q3. Your median will be here. Right. This is your 50th percentile, okay, 50th percentile, or the Q2, we say Q2, okay. One second, let me write it neatly. This is my maximum, yeah, this is my 50th percentile, okay, this is my Q2. So this is median. You might be wondering why it is not there in the middle, right? It need not to be there exactly in the middle, okay? It can be somewhere here, it can be somewhere here, okay? But if you look at the entire data, right? 25% of the data here, and 25% of the data is here, and 25% of the data is here, and 25% is here. So net-net, your entire data got divided into four equal parts, okay? Using box plot, you can plot the five number summary. So this is the box plot, is a visual representation. It helps us to understand how spread, right? How spread out the given data is. And also the box plot is helpful in terms of detecting the outliers. It is helpful to detect outliers. Okay, so now you tell me in this data set, what is the outlier? In this data set, what is an outlier? Can you tell me? What is an outlier? What is an outlier? Abnormally very high value, abnormally very less value. But we don't see any abnormality, right? So most of them were somewhat closer to each other. We don't see any abnormality. Something if you find 200, 150, you know, if it is too far from the existing values, then we call it. So can we conclude that we don't have any outlier in this data set? Can we say like this? See here, there is a formula to identify the outlier. Okay, the maximum, you cannot say the maximum values, you know, anything above maximum is outlier, anything below the minimum is you know, the outlier. We cannot say that. We also, are there any formula? Is there? Yes, there is a formula to identify this. The formula is this one. What is it? One second. So 1.5. see, to understand the, see, on the left side, to identify the outlier on the left side, or identify the outlier on the right side, we use two different formulas. But more or less, both of them are same only. Yeah, the difference between these two, the Q3 minus Q1, Q3 minus Q1 is called your IQR, interquartile range. Okay, so here what we do is, the lower quartile value, which is nothing but Q1, minus 1.5 into the IQR. What is the IQR? Q3 minus Q1. In this case, what is the Q3 here? The Q3 is 83 minus 72.5. How much you will get? You will get 71, right? 2.5, 0.5. 0.5. In this case, 0.5. This is to identify the left in. To identify the outlier on the left side, right? To identify the outlier on the right side, the upper quartile value, upper quartile is Q3 plus the right side, you know, is plus 1.5 into the IQR. What is the IQR? IQR is 0.5, right? So what is the Q3 in this case? The Q3 is 83. Plus, how much you will get?
7.2.
7.2, huh? Okay. 7.2. Here, the Q1 is, what is the Q1 here? Q1 is 72.5 minus 1.5 into 5. 7.5, right?
You'll get 0.75.
Oh, sorry, 0.75. 0.75. Here also 0.75.
Yes.
So here 83.75. 83.75. And what value will get it here?
7.5. 71.5.
Oh, this is, yeah, 71.5, right? Actually, the Q1 is, 72.5 already.
Yeah, minus.
It's minus. Sorry, minus. You are correct, right? 71.5, 83.5. That means any value which is above 83.75 and any value which is 7.5 is called your outlier. Do you have any value less than 71.5? Yes. Right, any value which is less than 71.5, this one, these three are outlier. This is how you need to find out the outlier. And any value which is greater than 83.75, right, 83.7, that means these are all outliers. It is as simple as this, okay? This is how you need to find out the outlier. See, the, some people, they say the lower quartile, LQ, minus 1.5, into IQR. This is the formula. Okay. And this is your upper quartile plus 1.5 into your IQR. Okay. This is how you will be finding out the outlier. Okay. The box plot is very much helpful to find out the outlier. Okay. So when you use the statistical software, you will find something like this. Okay. You will find some dot dot above and below the mean. That means anything above this are called your outlier. Anything above this one is called your outlier. Okay. It will show you something like this. Okay. Fine. So now what we will do is the next thing is the IQR, right? IQR is the one tells you the spread of your data, right? If the IQR is too high, that means the spread is very high. And in this case, the median is not falling exactly in the middle. Okay, that means this data is right skewed, right skewed. So if you look at it in the, what is that? In the histogram, it will be something like this. This is, if you use histogram, it will be like this. But when you use a box plot, it will be like this. If this line is exactly in the middle, if it is exactly in the middle, that means normally distributed data. So here the spread and here the spread, both of them are same. That means the median is there in the middle. That means it is normally distributed. Okay, it can also be something like this. Okay, if your median is somewhat here, right? That means the spread is very wide here. That means it is a negatively skewed data. Okay, so using box plot also, we can find out the distribution pattern of your given variable, quantitative variable. And also using box plot, we can find out the outlier. Okay. I'll just, give you some simple assignment. Now itself, you can try to solve that so that you will be able to recollect how to find out all these things. Okay. Let me just put something like some numbers here. Let's say I have the age, two variables. Okay. Age and number of customers. Number of customers, age is 19, number of customers are 2, and year 20 and 1, and year 21 and 1, and let's use some 22 and 23 and 24, 25, some age, okay, less than all young guys, okay, 3, 2, 1, 1. So now you tell me what is the median here. Just look at the number of customers and tell me what is the median here. You will be tempted to say, right, these two values are in the, not this one, and 3 is the median. It is not the correct answer because in the case of age, in the age 19, right, the two guys are there. Hence, you need to write it something like 2 19s and 120 and 121 and 322s are there. and 223s are there, and 24 and 25. So now what is the median? What is the middle?
22,
right? So two,
11 values are there. So sixth value will be the median.
Yeah, 2, 4, sixth is the median, right? This is what your median. What is the Q1 and Q3?
Actually, for number of customers for 22 is 3, right? Then we need to add 3 22s, right? Here we have only 2 22s.
Sorry. 22 is 3, right? Correct. You got 3 22s and 21 is 1. 1 21 and 3 22. And listen, yeah, 23 is 2, right? Yeah, 23 is 2 and 22 is 3. Correct. 22 is 3. So in that case, what is the median now?
22 is the median.
Yeah, so 22, right? So 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, 11. Yeah, this is the 3. Yeah, this is the one is the median, right? This is the median. 50th percentile. Okay, and just beneath this, right? Whatever value you have it. So here 2, 4, 5. So here, right? So yeah, you need to say 2, 4, 6, and here 2, 4, 5. Okay, 11 is there, right? Okay, sorry. This is the, in that case, right? You have 11, right? Just beneath this, you need to find out a median. So the median is 20. And just above this, you need to find out the median.
23.
23 is the median.
Q1 is 20, Q3 is 23.
Exactly. Q1 is 20, and the Q2, we say, right, Q2 is
22,
and Q3 is
23,
right? This is how you need to interpret this one, okay? And you know how to find out the outlier, right? So outlier, the left side and right side, how to find out the outlier. Now you tell me what is the outlier in this data set. Can you take your pen and paper and can you tell me quickly? What is the upper quartile here? Upper quartile is... Or, you know, let's say the lower quartile. Start with the lower quartile. What is the lower quartile? Q1, 20, minus 1.5. Into what is the IQR? Q3 minus Q1. 23 minus 20 is?
3.
3, right?
Two. Yeah, 3.
3, right? So, yeah. Q3 minus Q1. Okay, 3. And on the other 15. side?
15.5. Yes.
21.5.
Yeah, 23 minus plus 1.5 into 3, 4.5 here, and here 20, any value above 27.5 is called your outlier, and here 4.5, right? So here
15.5 will be their answer.
So do we have any outlier in this data set? We don't have.
No.
Right?
We don't have any.
Very good. Right? So in the previous scenario, we found outliers on both the left and right side. In some cases, you might find the outlier on the right side or the left side alone. But some cases, you will not have any outlier. So in this data set, we don't have any outlier at all. Right? Anything you know, less than 15.5, we don't have anything less than 15.5, right?
Yeah,
it is not there. Yeah, nothing is there. Here also nothing. No outlier. Good. So now you understood how to interpret the box plot. Okay. Now I will give you one tricky situation. Okay. And with that, you tell me what. See, these are the things. You know, as a data scientist or data science, sorry, are the statistician, you should be knowing it. Let's see, I have some values like this. Let's say, you know, I'm going to draw a box plot. The box plot is also called as box and whisker. Something like this. I'm going to, okay, this is kind of a skewed data. And this is somewhat like, you know, the 70s there here. And let's say, you know, this is my
Q1.
83, and this is like, you know, 85 and something like 90 is here, and 95 is here, and here's something called 100, somewhat like, you know, 100 is there. So what is the minimum? See, I plotted the sales achieved by my sales team. This is the sales values. Okay, the sales are achieved by my sales team members. I just plotted this using a box plot. Let's see, this is my scale. Okay, this is my scale. Don't think, you know, this is the Q1, Q2, Q3 and all. Okay, because you might be asking what the hell this one is all about. Okay, this is a scale. This is the scale I used it. Now you tell me, what is the minimum sales achieved here?
70.
Yeah, the minimum sales achieved was 70. What is the maximum sales achieved?
100.
Now you tell me, this is a very simple thing. What was the median sales achieved? 85. Obvious, right? So 85, yeah. Right? 85. This is the median sales achieved.
85.
And now the question is, the majority of the sales were above 85. Is that true or false?
Yes.
Something. It might be false.
Why it is false?
Might be volume can be high. Sorry.
Mm-hmm. Can you make it a little bit more clear?
Number of sales may be less and the price may be high. That kind of situation it might be.
This is not price data, it is sales data, right?
When you say sales is a number of order you are trying to say?
Yeah, number sales in terms of dollars, $85,000, $90,000, $95,000. The question is, the majority of the sales were above 85. Is that true or false? 85,000.
Partially yes, partially no.
Yeah, 50% of the data here and 50% of the data is here, right? Yeah,
median will not conclude about the differences, right? It will be middle, right?
Yeah.
So the rightly skewed.
Majority of the sales were above the median. Is that correct or? Okay, the next question is very simple question. What is the top 25% of the sales?
70 to 83.
No, top 25.
Sorry, 95 to 100.
Right? Yeah, that's correct. Top 25% of the sales.
Falls under 95 to 100.
Let's say the top 25% sales were between. We can say between, right? 95 yeah. And 100. Between 95 and 100. Okay, and the next question is, let's say if somebody says, right, the middle 50% of the sales achieved were between which range? Middle 50% of the sales were achieved between which range?
83 to 95.
83 to 95. Okay, very good. Right, so middle 50% of the data, right? So 83 to
95.
Middle 50% of the sales achieved. Sales achieved were between 83 to 95. Fine. Okay. So this is how in it, because for this, right, the 25% of the data is here. 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 Okay, so this is right, 25%. So the middle 25%, the middle 20% is here, right? The middle 25 is there,
yeah.
In the middle. This is what your median, right? The median is here. Hence, the middle 50% of the data covers 80 through 95. Now you tell me with this, you got some clarity. What is the difference between the standard deviation and the box plot? Yeah.
Actually, box plot shows like the percentage of distribution of the sales here. So 83 to 85 will have a short space, but it covers 25% of data. So the most of the sales happened in 83 to 85.
Yeah, look here. See, with this box plot, right? we can tell where the 50%, see, if I wanted to know the middle 50% of sales were achieved between which range, you can tell, right? Let's see, if somebody is asking, what is the top 25% of the sales achieved? Or bottom 25% of the sales achieved. See, this is the bottom 25% of sales. But with standard deviation, can you tell this? Using standard deviation, you can tell only the variation, right? You cannot tell, which data is falling in which location. You cannot tell that. You can tell only the variation, right? Are you guys agreeing with me?
Yeah, got it.
Right, with the 50% of the data lies between these two ranges, right? 83 to 95. But can you tell with that, with standard deviation?
We cannot.
Okay. And this is one of the beauty of the IQR and the Q1, Q2, Q3 and all, right? So the quartiles, the beauty of the quartiles or percentile is you can tell where exactly the specific values are lying between, right? The top 25% or the bottom 25%. See, the 75% is 95, right? That means, what does it say? 75th percentile. See, the 75th percentile, this is my 75th or quartile 3. The sales achieved was $95,000 at 75th quartile. What does this say? That means, right, the remaining 25% of the sales were achieved more than 95. Remaining 25% of the sales were achieved between 95 to 100. So in other words, right, the 75th percentile, if I say, what does it say? The sales achieved by the, this salesperson, right? This salesperson, let's take another scenario. Each values were achieved by different salesperson. Each values achieved by the different salesperson. It is a bit tricky, okay? If I say, this is Kumar's sale. Okay, Kumar, are you there? Okay, the Kumar achieved $95,000. But his percentile is 75. What does it say? That means 75% of my sales team, they achieved sales either 95 or less than $95,000. That is what I explained when I discussed about percentile. Am I correct? Right? 75% of my sales team, they achieved the sales either $95,000 or less than $95,000. Now you tell me, what is the, majority of the sales were achieved. Majority of the sales were achieved above 85 is true or false. That means 50% of my employees, either they achieved $85,000 or less than $85,000. That means, the remaining 50% of my sales team, they achieved either 85 or more than 85. 85 or more than 85. 50% of my sales team achieved either 85 or more than 85. Right? On the other hand, right? 50% of my employees achieved $85,000 or less than $85,000. Right? So we can say this way also. And your top 25% of the sales. In this case, what is the top 25% of sales? 95 to 100, right? The same thing, 95 to 100. This is 95, 95 and 100. So this is my 70th percentile, right? And the top 25 falls here. This is my top 25, this is my bottom 25. Fine. The next one is, what are the other things? A quartile, okay, let us see what sorry the IQR, right? We discussed about IQR. Let's say I'll put some data here so that let's say I have something like 5,000 and let's say 500,000. Okay, 500,000, and let's say 5,001 and 5,001, 5,025 and 5,050, something like that. Now you tell me, what is the Q1, Q2, Q3 in this data set? What is the minimum maximum? Obviously, this is my minimum, right? This is my maximum. Okay. And what is the median here? Median is this one. And what is the Q1 here?
5001.
Yeah, this is my Q1, obviously. This is my Q1. What is my Q3? This is what my Q3. What is the IQR here? What is the IQR? Interquartile range. Q3 minus Q1.
49.
5050. Minus 50.
Oh, 49, right?
49, yeah, 49.
49. This is what? 49. IQR is 49. Okay. Now you tell me, does the. So let's say, if I ask you a question like, about 50% of the data covered by IQR. Is that true or false? About 50% of the data covered by IQR. Is that true or false? So Q3 minus Q1, right? Sorry, this is the one. We never say Q4, right? So you are 25%, right? This 25%, you are 25%. So the 50%, about 50% of data is covered by your IQR, Q3 minus Q1. Yeah, 50, 25 plus 25, right?
Yeah.
50% of data covered by
okay.
My IQR. This is true. Does IQR is affected by an outlier? We have an outlier here. It's quite obvious. This is my outlier, right? This is my, it's very big value, normally very high value. This is an outlier. Or you can use that formula also. Okay, this is my outlier. So does my IQR is affected by outlier? No, right?
No.
Q3, Q minus Q. Hence, IQR is resistant to outlier. So those people got infected by virus or bacteria, you must have heard about this, right? That means, sir, we cannot give any tablets because all the antibiotic tablets are resistant to her infection. That means there is no medicine to cure her. If you give any antibiotic, it will not kill the bacteria. Okay, and the next question is, IQR is not affected by outlier. That is what we conclude with this one, right? IQR is not affected by outlier. Can you tell me whether it is true now? Okay, IQR is affected by every value in the data set. Is that true? IQR is affected by every value in the data set. Is that true?
Yes.
No. IQR is not affected by every value, right? It is affected by only by Q3 and Q1.
Okay, got it, yeah.
Now you tell me, what is the difference between standard deviation and versus IQR? I'll give you some data, okay? A is equivalent to 1, 1, 1, for illustration purpose, I'm using all ones here. And I have another data set called B. B is equivalent to, so 1, 1, 1, 1, something like this. Okay, this is my another data set. What is the IQR for these two things, these two data sets?
0.
Very good, right? This is 0. The IQR is 0. 1 minus 1 is 0, right? Here also the six values are the two middle values. Yeah, so that means the right, so the Q, these two are the my 0. IQR is 0 for both data sets. Yeah. But what is the standard deviation? You have to take the mean and you need to subtract from each and every value. You need to square it, right? Obviously, the standard deviation is going to be different from the IQR. Right? So, standard deviation is different, whereas IQR is 0 here. In so first one is better.
For standard deviation also, it comes 0, right? Because you are going to minus what a mean from the each end. So, what mean will
be 6. 6 divided by 6. Right? 6 divided by 6 is 1, right? You will get 1 here, standard deviation. Am I correct?
Yes.
Sorry, the mean. The mean is 1. Yeah, you are correct. So 1 minus 1, 0. 1 minus 1, 1 minus 0. Here also 0.
Zero, yes.
But here, it is not 0, right?
Not 0, yes.
It is not 0. N is the standard deviation. So which one is better? Standard deviation or IQR?
IQR.
Yeah.
IQR is better.
Yeah. See, the IQR tells us where the middle 50% of data is located. But with standard deviation, we cannot tell, right? It just tells us about the spread of the data.
Yes.
Try to understand. Standard deviation just tells us the spread, how spread out the data. The higher the standard deviation, see, look here. See, obviously, the standard deviation value will get more here. That means higher the standard, higher volatility. But here, you know, there is no variation because all the values are closer. Hence, the spread is 0. You know, the spread is not much, right? But here spread is, you know, big. It tells us only the spread. Whereas the IQR tells us where the middle 50% of the data lies, right? And also with this IQR, we can understand the IQR also, right? It tells us it is resistant to outliers. Even though you have outlier, it doesn't take into account of the outlier. But in the case of standard deviation, you need to include the outlier also in your data set, right? So IQR is resistant or not sensitive to outlier, whereas standard deviation is sensitive to outlier, to summarize, okay? With standard deviation, right, we can understand the spread of the data, whereas with the help of IQR, we can understand where the middle 50% of data is there, right? We can locate the middle 50% of the data, but with standard deviation, you cannot find it. That is the difference between the IQR standard. Hope you are clear about what is quartile 1, how to find out Q1, Q3, what is IQR, and also you understood how we can plot the fine number summary in a box plot. And using box plot also, we can find out the spread of the data, like histogram. Right. So with this, you're very clear. I think, you know, this much is sufficient for you to understand the descriptive statistics part. Okay, what we will do is we will directly jump into the inferential statistics part. Okay. What is inferential statistics? So it is quite interesting. This one is very good. I don't know how many of you tried E power soft. This one is very, it's free and the recording part. Okay, I don't know when I use this one, it is hanging. The recording quality, everything is very good. Even Zoom, if you record it, after ending the session, it takes a lot of time to generate the file. But it generates the MP3 or MP4 file instantly. Just give me a second, I'll just enable this. Fine, we are all set. Hope it should not cause any problem. Okay. What is inferential statistics? Let's try to understand it. Now let us try to understand inferential statistics. This is the second branch of the statistics, inferential statistics. And we, so far we discussed about descriptive statistics. What is descriptive statistics? As part of descriptive statistics, we discussed about the measures of central tendency, measures of spread. Okay. What exactly descriptive? Using descriptive statistics, we can summarize the data. Using descriptive, we can summarize the data. And also we can use some visualization, right? Visualization tool like box plot or histogram to understand the spread of the data. And also we can use some tabular, right? Tables to show the frequency, everything, right? How many number of customers between the age group, 25 to 30, they purchased more than 50,000, right? How they spend more than 50,000. The frequency distribution table, right? You can using descriptive in simple term, you can give the gist or summary of the data, either visually or you can, you know, the using the five number summary, box plot, using box plot, we can show it to the management. See, box plot is meant for data scientist or statistician. Okay, like the histogram and box plot, it is meant for data scientists. Keep that in mind. Only a data statistician or data scientist can interpret that one. But as your data scientist or statistician, you should interpret what is median, what is IQR, everything. And when you give, but you need to interpret by using the fine number summary, the distribution pattern of your data, or where the middle 50% of the data exists, everything you need to interpret it, and you need to share it with the stakeholders. Like the minimum sales achieved, maximum sales achieved with this one. This is what the first quartile value. This is what the second quartile, third quartile value. This is the median sales achieved. The middle 50% of sales were achieved between, so top 25% sales achieved between this one. So this is the one you are supposed to share it with the management, because this is the business insight. Okay. So now you understood, right? You need to transform the statistical or the box plot visualization, whatever you said, you need to transform it into business language. Only then the stakeholders can understand. Whatever you translate it and, you know, give the business insights to the management, which is nothing but this five number summary or six number summary, right? That is nothing but summary data, gist of the data, no matter what is the volume of the data. Let's say you have 10 million volume of data is there, but you give them, this is the minimum sale achieved, this is the maximum sale achieved, this is the key one, this is the top 20% sales, this is the middle 50% sales achieved. So with this, we are able to understand the characteristics of the data, right? At an high level. So what is inferential statistics? Inferential statistics is basically the descriptive statistics gives you the high level overview about the data. For example, right, we have mean here, the mean sales, what is the average sales achieved or median sales achieved? You say the mean sales achieved is $100,000. But with that, can you say the entire population, for the entire population, the average sale is 100,000 with the sample mean, right? With the sample mean, can we infer the population mean? With the sample mean, can we infer the population mean? See, in the real world, see, in the inferential statistics, we talk about only the sample. In real world, we don't work with population data. First of all, we will not have access to the population data because it is a time consuming process and you require more resources. Okay, you might be, or for the sake of debating, right? You might be saying, hey, Satya, mine is a startup company. We just started 1 year back. We don't have millions and millions of data. Can I say, in that case, why should I use sample? Can I use the population data?
Yes, in your case it is fine because your population data itself, you know, the sample data only, it's not very huge volume of data. Let's say your company has grown up or you are running a survey, you wanted to, though your company is a startup company, you wanted to know where you stand compared to your rivalry companies like Flipkart, Amazon, where you stand, right? So in that case of, let's say you are into e-commerce, but you sell only the grocery items, right? Different segments, the other, your competitors are selling in almost all the segments like apparels, electronics, and kids items, like, you know, different segments they are selling the items, but you are targeting only grocery. Still, you need to know where they stand in order to understand, right? In the grocery, in the grocery itself, right, of specific items, let's, you know, rice, what is the, you know, sales achieved by or revenue generated by Flipkart in rice within this grocery segment, or dal, right, how much they, what is the sales, and also, right, the daily care, you have something called daily care. What is daily care? You will be using the soap, right, every day you'll be using soap, and you'll be using the Colgate likewise, right? These are the daily care items, right? So in the daily care, within this segment, right, you sell daily care items and also these things, okay, and cleaning products likewise, right? So if you want to compare the top giants, right, like a Flipkart and Amazon or Target, their sales volume is very big, right? But you cannot literally run a survey with their entire employees or entire customers, right? The Walmart, the 1 hour sale is close to 1 million transactions, 1 hour sales itself, right? 1 million, 1 hour, let's, you know, 24 hours, if you take the sale, right, approximately 20 million will be there, transactions. Within this transaction, again, in the daily care, how many of them they purchased, how many items they purchased. So from the population, whether you are a startup company or a bigger company, right, to compare with your competitors' wallet share or market share, right, you need to run a survey. In order to run a survey, you cannot contact all the customers of Walmart or all the customers of Target or Flipkart. It is a time-consuming process. When it comes to influence statistics, we'll be using sample only. You think Walmart, they don't have the entire data? Yes, we can take the entire data is available on Hadoop, but still it is meaningless to take the entire data because we have various sampling techniques are available. With the help of sampling techniques and inferential statistics, other techniques are available using which we can inference the population. When I can inference the population data with the sample data itself, why should I take the entire population data? That is what the question. Okay, if I use a sample, right? Okay, so using inferential statistics, in the case of inferential statistics, we can make an inference about the population using the sample data itself. Okay, now the question is, in the case of descriptive statistics, you cannot make an inference about your population using the summary value itself. See, even in the case of sample, we take the mean, okay? But here we simply describe the characteristics of the data, that's all. But here also we are using mean only, right? You might be asking, sample is nothing but you have a sample data, okay? Even in the sample, we take the average sales. With the sales, we are able to inference the population. So here also we are taking the mean, right? Let's say you are taking the sample data, the mean. With that, why can't I in? Because in the case of inference statistics, we have something called confidence interval and central limit theorem. Importantly, central limit theorem. And we have something called central limit theorem, confidence interval, confidence level. Confidence interval and confidence level, these two things are different. In addition to the mean, right, we use confidence interval, confidence level, central limit theorem, like various techniques that we'll be using it in order to infer the population mean. Let's say this is my population mean using my sample mean. Whereas in the case of discrete, we don't have the confidence interval, confidence level and all available. Okay, so this is what the distinction between or the discrimination between these two statistics. This discrete statistics talks only about the summary of the data. That's it, full stop. In the case of inference statistics, we take the sample data with the sample mean, we infer the population mean using various techniques, because these techniques are available as part of inferential statistics. So this is the exact difference between the discrete and inference. Apart from this, apart from inferring the population mean using the sample mean, we can predict the probability. We have something called probability theory, right? Using probability theory, we can make a prediction. And also we have statistical models like machine learning algorithms, linear regression, logistic regression, using which also we can make a prediction using historical data. That's all. That's the difference between descriptive statistics and inference statistics. In the case of descriptive statistics, we summarize the data. And also sometimes what we do is we show the summarized data in visualization, like the box plot or something like that. Okay. That's all. But in the case of inference statistics, we infer the population mean using the sample mean, using various techniques, okay? The central limit theorem, all these things, okay? The confidence interval, confidence level, central limit theorem, so on and so forth. And also we have probability theory. Using probability theory also, we can make a prediction, statistics. This is the difference between these two, okay? Fine. The next one is, So next, what we will do is we'll try to understand certain notations, okay? Some notations. So we know the statistical the measures, right? Statistical measures. What are the statistical measures? We discussed about the mean, right? The mean. And for a sample, sorry, the size, right? Size of the data, sample size, right? We say N. And this is Novarro Littoral statistical measures. Okay, so I mean, and median, we don't use any notation, mean, median, and standard deviation. Standard deviation, we use small s. Okay, small s. These are statistical measures. Or we, in simple term, they call it statistic. When you talk about the sample, we use the term statistic, okay? When you talk about the population, we call it as a parameter. See, we have something like, right? This is my population. This is my sample. Maybe you can draw more than one sample. This is my population. From the population, I can draw n number of samples. Let's say this sample one and sample two and so on, right? We can draw multiple samples. So we use small n to represent the sample size. We use capital N to represent the population size, okay? And the mean of your population, we use a notation called mu. Standard deviation is sigma. I don't want to talk too much of theory, okay? The notation and all, I don't want to discuss so many notations. Okay, just if you remember these three simple or these two simple thing, if you remember, that's more than enough. Mean, standard deviation, and your population mean, population standard deviation. Just give me a second. Okay, I'll come back in a minute. Okay. Sorry, I have a visitor at the gate. That's the reason why I went there. Okay, so these are the notation we'll be using, right? So these small n is representing the sample size, and capital N is nothing but population size. Okay, and these are the notation that we'll be using it. Okay, so now I told you these are all called these measures, right? The statistical measures like x bar, small s are called statistic, right? Mu and sigma are called your parameter. So in the case of inferential statistic, we estimate the population parameter using statistic. Most of the time we estimate only the mean only. So here, what is the statistic? X bar. X bar is sample mean. Estimate the population parameter, mu, right? So we estimate the population mean using the sample statistic, x bar, it is x1 bar, x2 bar. With this, we'll be estimating the population. One simple example is, for example, Kumar, are you there? You're a college student, okay? See, in a college, you'll take a simple college example. In the case of college exam, in the case of college, right? The final year college students. Let's take the final year college student. Final year college students. Let's say in the final year, college, right? The number of students are, let's say 2,000 students are final year. They are doing their final year in a college. So we wanted to know what is the average or age of the final year college student. Average age of the final year college students. It's here in this case, the population N, the number of final year students are 2000. Okay. And we need to estimate the average age of these final year 2000 students. Okay. Average age of the 2000 students of the final year, we need to estimate it. First of all, we don't know what is the average age of these two final year 2000 students, right? So what we are doing is, let's say Kumar is running a survey. So he is randomly contacting 20 final year student. And he is asking the 20 final year student age. Okay, and he records everything. And for the 20 students, the mean is something like 21 years. This survey was, this survey ran by Kumar. And I have, I have Bala. Bala is here. Okay, what he says is, no, as per my sample, the average age is 22. X2 bar. I ran a survey with 10 different or 20 different students randomly. With my sample data, the average age of the average age is 22. For this sample 2, the average age is 22. For the sample 1, the average age is 21. Sample to sample, the mean is different. Can you say the average age of all the 2000 final year student age is 21? Can you say like that? If you say like this, this guy, Bala is, he is creating conflict. He says, no, it should be 22. Now we are in dilemma. So can we use 21 or sample to sample? The mean is different, but there are due to random chance, there are some sample mean will be same as other sample mean, but majority of the sample mean will not be identical. Sample to sample mean is different. Okay. What is there any way if I can say confidently that the average age of the entire students, 2000 student age is so and so. Can I say 21? No. If I can I say 22? No. Because who knows when other guy randomly run a survey with other 20 students, he might tend to get 20 years. Sample 1, 21, sample 2, 22, and sample is 20 years. So how can we generalize the population mean based on the sample? Can you make a wild guess? I'll give you one clue. Let's say your manager is asking you, right? So tomorrow, what time can I expect you in the office? Tomorrow, what time in the morning can I expect you? Will you say 10 a.m.? Or you say 10:30 a.m.? So one guy says 10 a.m. Let's say you are saying 10 a.m., but your manager, if you say 10 a.m., right? Your manager is very, very, strict guy. He expect you to be at office sharp by 10 a.m. Right? I gave you the clue also, right? But better what you're doing is, instead of saying 10 a.m., man, I'll be there by 10:30 a.m. But if you say 10:30 a.m. and if you, reach the office little earlier, right? Even that case also is very, sensitive. He says, hey, you said 10:30 a.m. you came little earlier. If you come little late also a problem, little earlier also a problem. Let us assume that way, okay? In that case, how do you handle him? How do you handle him?
Provide some range.
Very good, right? Very good range. So what you say, if you come little early also a problem, if you come little late also a problem, right? So what you hey man, between 10 to 10:30 a.m. I'll be here. Anywhere between 10 to 10:30 a.m., right? So it's smart way of saying, this is where the confidence interval is coming into picture, right? Using confidence interval, we can generalize the population. Anywhere between 10 to 10:30 a.m., my population mean will be falling, right? Now let's go back to this example, 21, 22, right? So 21, 22, instead of taking multiple samples, right? See, taking multiple samples was a painful process, right? Sample one is 21, average, sample two average is 22. See, in the case of real world, especially in the case of sales, right? If you take 1 week sales randomly, and other week sales, last 15 days sales, you wanted to, generalize, right? Let's say in the case of peanut butter, how many number of bottles in an average we can sell it in the north region? Somebody's asking you, right? So you, instead of saying one simple number, a single number, you can say some range of values. So anywhere between 200 to 300, you are safe. If you say 150, right, what will happen is maybe the demand is more, but you underquoted the value, right? Because of which we lost the sales. So that is where we'll be defining some range. So instead of, and also, right, taking multiple samples, drawing multiple samples, also a painful thing. Use a single sample to generalize the population. Is it possible to use a single sample to generalize the population? If I do it, sample to sample, the mean is different. So instead of taking multiple samples with a single sample, if I have to generalize the population, the only way out is define some range. And that is where we have something called confidence interval is coming into picture. Let's go back to the same example, 21. And 22, instead of taking multiple samples, I take only this sample 21. Mean, the mean of sample one is 21. I define a range here, right? So this is called my confidence interval. Let's say 21 minus 1.5, 21 minus 1.5, and I add 1.5, minus 1.5 plus 1.5. So 19.5 is my lower limit. My upper limit is 22.5. Probably, you know, some students, right, they would have failed during their school time, or they would have taken a break, because of which, right, their age would have been more, right? So anywhere between the entire final year, the 2000 students' average age falls anywhere between 19.5 to 22.5. So the population mean falls anywhere between these two values. It can be here, or it can be here, or it can be anywhere, right? So what we are doing is we are, you know, defining a range of value. This is my upper, lower limit, upper limit. Now the question is, why did you subtract 1.5 and why did you add 1.5? So are there any rational behind this? Yes, there is a formula for this. Okay, there is a formula for this. So there is a formula for this, okay? Right, so we'll discuss about that little later. At this moment, high level understand, okay? So now what happens? Anywhere between 19.5 to 22.5. This is Kumar. Kumar, he says, the population mean falls anywhere between 19.5 to 22.5. Now what he says, right, Bala? He says, no. Anywhere between 20.5 to 23.5. My range is, as per my sample, my confidence interval is different. Right? So that is where there is something called confidence level came into picture. Let us say if Kumar says the confidence interval, the population mean falls anywhere between 19.5 to 22.5. Let's say I am the manager, I'll ask Kumar, hey, as per your sample, you are saying the population mean falls anywhere between 19.5 to 22.5. But how confident are your confidence interval or the range of values which you came up, right? How confident are you that your the range of values holding the population mean? Now we understood this is what the confidence interval, 19.5 to 22.5. Anywhere between 19.5 to 22.5, the population mean will be there. But still we don't know, okay? See, when you use a sample, there is a degree of uncertainty because your sample is not same as your population. But remember that when your sample size is very big, as your sample size is big, right? When your sample size becomes large, the variation is very less. Keep that in mind, okay? So he says, right? So this is what your confidence interval, and we have something called confidence level, right? Confidence level, we use conventionally three different things, 90, 95, and 99, like in Chebyshev's, right? Here also three numbers you remember, it 99. In general, we use 90%, 95%, 99%. If Kumar says, hey, there is a 95% confident, I am 95% confident that the population mean can fall anywhere between 19.5 to 22.5. What does that mean? See, in this case, you are confident. Sorry, see, in this case, you are defining a range. That is nothing but your confidence interval. You are telling your manager that anywhere between 10 to 10:30 a.m. Now he is asking you another question. What is the assurance that you will be coming here between 10 a.m. to 10:30 a.m.? You thought you were smart and you defined a range, but he is much smarter than you. He is asking, what is the assurance that you will be coming anywhere between 10 to 10:30 a.m.? You will say, right, hey, 100% sure, or 95%. Still you say 95% is confident. I am 95% confident that I can reach office anywhere between 10 to 10:30 a.m. What does that mean? You're not telling 100%, right? Why you are not telling 100% confident that I can come to office anywhere between 10 to 10:30 a.m.? Why are you not telling it? Why you can't tell? Because there are some uncertainty, right? Maybe on the way, right, the chief minister may be crossing the road. Or some riot can happen due to some, you know, vehicle breakdown. Anything can happen. So what it says is 90% confidence. Still, there is a 5% chances that I cannot reach office between this range. There is a 5% chance that I cannot reach the office within this. So the 95% confidence tells, right, how confident that your population mean falls in between these values. If Kumar says 95% confident that the population mean can fall anywhere between these two things. But if he says, right, 99%, obviously the interval will, you know, will the it will become wider. So here we'll say, you know, 18.5 to 23.5 is more safe. There is a 99% confident that between 18 to 23.5 only, the average, anywhere between these two ranges only, the age falls. As you increase the confident level, right? So what, see, the simple analogy is, your manager is a very stringent guy, right? Very strict guy. And if you define this range also risk, right? What you do is, okay, now he's asking, what is the confidence that you will be available anywhere between 9 to 10:30 a.m., man? So if you say in, with the 95% confident, right, you will not be happy. If you say 99% confident, what you have to do? So between anywhere between 10 to 11 a.m., right? See, the range increases. As you increase the confidence level, the interval also increases, right? That is, so there is a formula for this. We will discuss it once again tomorrow in tomorrow's session, because statistics you need to understand very clearly with formula, everything, right? Formally we'll explain you, and followed by that, we'll explain you the various sampling techniques, okay? And please bear with me, okay? And there is some issue in my website to create the new user ID, okay? I'm working on it with the help of some PHP and JavaScript guys. Most likely this upcoming Tuesday, I'll be able to create new user IDs. Once I share the IDs, you can go to my website. One second, I'll just, it is not there here. See, my website is, this is the one, Data to Business Insights in. Almost all the study materials are there. Many of them missed out even today's session. Okay, let it be there. See here, it's already, see, once you log in here, right? The username, password, I'll share it. This Tuesday, so data science course, if you select here and go to the next page, and here you will find all these things in front, descriptive statistics, study material, and the pre-recorded video, and where is the inferential statistics? Yeah, this is the one, the confidence interval, study material, and confidence interval. And central limit theorem. We'll discuss about central limit theorem. This is one of the important theorem in statistics. Okay, central limit theorem and confidence interval and confidence level with formula. We'll say it. And also, if possible, and also the sampling techniques, various sampling techniques. Okay, and sampling distribution also very important. Okay, sampling distribution, central limit theorem, everything we'll discuss it tomorrow. Okay, so when I explain you all these things, you will be able to understand how in inferential statistics, we can use sample mean to estimate or infer the population mean, right? So that is it. So that's what, the same thing is applicable in real-time scenario, right? When your manager asks you, as a statistician, you can tell that the sales can be anywhere between so-and-so with the 95% confidence, or with the 99% confidence, with 95% confidence, you can tell. But you cannot say I'm 100% confident, because you are taking the sample data, right? With sample data, we cannot say 100% confident the sales can be anywhere between so on. So you cannot say, right? So 90, 95, 99%, right, we'll explain in detail. Again, you will be able to understand the confidence interval also, level also during the time of hypothesis testing. Okay, don't worry. Okay, we will discuss in detail the confidence interval in tomorrow's session. It's already 8, 9. Okay, sorry, I took much of your time than what I promised. Okay, and what we will do is tomorrow we'll continue with the sampling and various sampling techniques, everything. Okay, the confidence interval, confidence level, and if possible, we'll start the hypothesis testing also. Okay, and the meeting invite, you can use the same meeting invite. Probably I'll edit it, I'll change the date also tomorrow's thing. Okay, I think this is the one I scheduled long back. Yeah, I think the same meeting invite will work tomorrow. Okay, any questions so far?
The list of softwares you said you will be sharing us.
I'll tell you now itself. See, you don't have to install so many things. I will tell you. See, one is Python. Okay, the first one is Python. Okay, and Python you don't have to don't download Python and all. Okay, download Anaconda. Okay, and number two is R. Download R, and also download R Studio. Okay, and the next one is SAS University Studio, but don't download it now, the SAS University, because it's kind of a trial version. Okay, they give it for 3 or 4 months time. Okay, SAS Studio, SAS University Edition. Okay, SAS University, but anyhow, you note it down. Okay, SAS University Edition, and these are the things you need to download it. Apart from this, in Python, we need to install a couple of packages like TensorFlow. Anyhow, you don't worry. Whenever I start the TensorFlow as part of machine learning algorithm, right, I will cover this one, when you need to install, how you need to install TensorFlow, everything. But the importantly, for Python, we'll be using GUI, right, the GUI or IDE, Integrated Development Environment, which is nothing but the editor, right? We use the notebook, Anaconda, or notebook, they say, the notebook, right? It's the Anaconda notebook. Google, right? So Google, what they do is, previously in the previous batches in IPython notebook. Okay, IPython notebook. So all you need to do is go and register yourself. It is a free registration. And Microsoft Azure notebook, if you go here, they give free space. Everything they already installed. Right? Jupyter notebook. Yeah, Jupyter notebook. Right? So this one. But now I think, they removed this option now. Okay, it is not available as a free thing. Okay, you need to, it's a paid one. Okay, earlier it was free. You can upload as much data as possible. And one more thing is, now we are left with Google Jupyter Notebook. One second. Collab. We have something called Google Collab. The beauty of this one is you can use GPU also. GPU, right? GPU is nothing but graphical processing unit. The GPU is 100 times faster than our normal CPU. So why we need GPU, the powerful GPU? Because the deep learning algorithms are CPU intensive process, because too much of mathematical calculations needs to be done. Too much of computations are needed. Okay, mathematical computations are needed. Hence, it requires high-end CPU, which is nothing but your GPU. One GPU is equivalent to 100 CPUs. Who knows, in future, everybody will be using GPUs. I saw in some blogs, already some, even freshers, right, they bought the laptop with GPU. It's very expensive one. Okay, but you don't have to spend any money here. You can come here. You have some option in Colab, Google Colab. So look here. So here, yeah, code. If you click here, right? So you will find something like this. For example, print. Welcome to the world of Hello World. Okay, Python. And then if you click this one, this is your Jupyter notebook. In Colab, in Google, they provide the cloud-based. Okay, if you execute this, right, it will display the output here itself. And apart from this, we have PyCharm, and we have something else called Spider. These are the IDs. You can use it to write the Python program. In simple term, you can use notebook, right? In notebook also, you can write the Python commands. A Python script, notebook, right? So notepad. You can use notepad test.py, but your file name extension should be py. But we use even Java. You can write it in the notepad itself. Why we need the code editor? Because it provides code completion feature. I'll explain what is code completion feature at the time of writing scripts in Python. Okay, so after completion of the inference statistics, we'll start work on the Python part. Okay, so look here, I executed my script. I could see the output here itself, right? See, the Python is interpreted, and it is right. So it's interpreted language, right? So you can see the output then and there using Jupyter notebook. That is one of the beauty of the Jupyter notebook. You can see the output then and there. And if you want to write another line of code, right, you can click code. You can add the new cell. These are called your cells. You can write. So any of write in simple term, you don't have to install Anaconda. We can use the cloud-based notebook, right? But still, I would urge you to use your install Anaconda in your local system. Go to Google. And what you do is download Anaconda. But when you download Anaconda, the beauty is the Jupyter notebook, Spider, everything will get installed as a package. It comes with a package, Anaconda for Windows. Anaconda. So now, even Anaconda, right, they made the Python thing as the commercial one. So open source is also Anaconda, data science toolkit. See, data science toolkit itself available now. Or if you come down here, see 3.8 and 64 bit, depends on the type of operating system you have. You can download it. 64 bit, you can download it and install it. If you're using Linux or Mac OS, you can download it and install it. You are downloading Anaconda, but when you download and install Anaconda, Python will get installed automatically. And also the Jupyter notebook, which is the code editor, we'll be using it. And also the Spider will also get installed. Using Spider also, we can write Python program, okay? But when it comes to data science, data analytics, we use this one because it's very interactive. Interactive, which one? The Jupyter notebook. Python is interpreted as well as interactive language. You can see the output then and there. The problem with the notebook is, notepad is, let's say you are writing a complex program. You have a thousand lines of code is there. When you execute your script, you will get errors in multiple places, right? So to debug that, you need to open your code and go to the specific line and check. But here it is not like that. As in when you execute, you'll get the error. You can fix it and then go to the next cell and you can. So that is the beauty of the interpreted language. So with Jupyter notebook, right? It is very interpreted one, okay? So anyhow, we'll discuss this. So in simple term, you install Anaconda, download Anaconda and install it. And then install R first. And then you use RStudio for R programming language, right? RStudio is the code editor. In RStudio only, we write the R program. And the R is the backend. Still, you need to have the backend R. First, you install this one, and then you need to install this one, right? That's all. And then SAS University Edition, You don't have to download it now. Probably after a month or so, right? You can install it. SAS University Edition also will cover it. Okay. So if you, and then we'll cover about the big data stuff. Right? Big data, you don't have to do anything. We have something, HTTP's Hawthorne works. Sandbox is available. Sandbox. What I will is, it is closer to 50 GB or so. Or 40 GB. What I will do is probably I will give you the dump, entire dump. All you need to do is just download and install VirtualBox or VMware. Better you can install VMware. Right? So even VMware also I will give it to you because VMware nowadays is a commercial one, right? If you get the free one, you can download it, install. Don't install the trial version, okay? I think still VMware free version is available. Probably you can download this one. Now it's a probably, who knows, right? After a week or after a month, they make it the commercial one. VMware free, you can download it and install it. See, this is what I did, VMware Workstation. Yeah, VMware Workstation, 12 player. This software is also available. Probably I will upload this one in my Google Drive and I'll share the link. I think already I did it for the previous batches, okay? And once you are done with this, look here, I'm using HTTP, Hawthorne Works. This is for Hadoop, Big Data Hadoop, okay? And SAS, and even for shell scripting, right? Unix shell scripting, I installed Ubuntu separately, okay? So you can install it and all you need to just download these images. I'll give you this image. It's a very big file. Okay, it's a very big file. If you go here, the settings, right? Very big file. Anyhow, don't worry. Again, the RAM required for this one is to open the image, right? The big data dump, right? Minimum 8 GB is required. But I have my RAM capacity is very good. So it's 10 GB I'm using it here, okay? So anyhow, it's too early to discuss about this. Let's not worry about this. At this moment, all you need to do is just download the Anaconda and install it. And then you download R and R Studio. That is enough. And Tableau also, don't do it now. We'll do it later. Tableau is also a very simple tool to learn, okay? Okay, any other questions?
We are all set. Hope I should not cause any problem.
Okay. Fine. Got recorded. Fine, yeah. Since you don't have any questions, yes, right? We will circle back tomorrow. Same time, 6 to 8 p.m. Okay. We'll use the same meeting invite. Okay.
Second branch of the statistics, inferential statistics.
Yeah. Fine. I'm going to end the session now.